Good evening, everyone. Clearly, there's an emergency on because Mr. Swamy has slipped away. Okay, he's back. Well, that was the kind of entry that Mr. Subramanian Swamy made in the peak of the emergency. He was away in America. He'd run away as a disguised as a Sikh. He was doing propaganda in favor of democracy in America. And then he was afraid that he would lose his Rajya Sabha seat. And so he came back to India with emergency fully in play. And he managed to slip into parliament just as they were reading out all the obituaries of leaders who had died. And Mr. Swamy said, "What about democracy? It's dead as well." And having made that emphatic remark, he slipped away with all those, the housemen in the hall still intact. So that was Mr. Swamy's most glorious moment in defense of democracy. Before we really enter this evening with him, I'd like to remind ourselves that Algebra really is a club for persuasion, for emotional and intellectual transformation. That's what the dragonfly stands for, and that's the kind of speakers we've been bringing to you. In many ways, Mr. Swamy is the great disruption. He doesn't believe in persuasion, he believes in disruption. He believes in challenge, he believes in discomfort. And there are many words in the English Oxford Dictionary that were particularly made for him. Radioactive, stormy petrel, gadfly, you know, you name it. They are all attached to Mr. Swamy. But most of all, Mr. Swamy comes from a long line of Brahmin fighters. And he has kept that craft of the family alive. In his long and extensive public career, he's picked fights with many people, starting with Mr. P.C. Mahal Nobis, the Chief Statistician of India, with Amartya Sen, with the Delhi School of Economics, with IIT, with Mr. Chidambaram, with Indira Gandhi, with Jayalalitha, with Mr. Vajpayee, and that's only the start of it. So it's fascinating to understand why an extremely, but all his adversaries will say two things about Mr. Swamy, that he is supremely intelligent and incorruptible. So why does a man like that stand up for the Hindutva dream? In this last week, he has said that Mr. Adityanath is the best choice that UP could have. He has introduced a bill in parliament asking for death penalty for cow slaughter. He is, of course, in the thick of the 2G scam, and he's also asked for the Ram Mandir to be built. And that's all in the day of Swami's 5 days of public life. So it's fascinating to understand how someone who finished his PhD in Harvard at 24 came back to India, ready to join an institution led by Mr. Amartya Sen, comes to be the chief spokesman for Hindutva in 2017 India. So ladies and gentlemen, to understand that journey, to understand these ideas, to understand what is the idea of India that Mr. Swamy is batting for, please welcome him on stage today. Well, we need 3 hours with you. You know, this is the first time that at least I have you at the end of my interrogatory line. So I want full privileges. But before we dive into the present, Dr. Swamy, I wanted to start a little in your past. In 1992, you wrote a book called Building a New India, an agenda for Renaissance. And in that, amongst many other ideas, you decried the idea of a Hindu Rashtra as a theological state that you reject. You also spoke of the retrogression of the BJP, the VHP, and its whole agenda as creating passionate dislike of other religions. 8 years later, you wrote a piece in Frontline talking about the creeping fascism of the RSS. And you used a very interesting phrase. You said you hoped that the vibrations of Mother India would prove to be their undoing. Can you talk to us about the idea of India you believed in then, in 1992 and in 2000?
I remember very vividly that the same question was asked of Jai Prakash Narayan too. In right from the independence struggle till 1974, when he teamed up with the Jansang to fight the dictatorial tendencies, as he said then, of Mrs. Indira Gandhi. This question used to be asked of him. This is what you said, this is what you said, this is what. Well, two things. One, RSS doesn't seem to take any umbrage at what I said. And therefore, I don't know why it bothers so many people that this is what you said then, and now you're with them. And as you know, in between a wife and a husband, sometimes they have a quarrel, they say awful things. Then they make up, and if the neighbor reminds them of what each said of the other.
I'd love to know in this relationship between the RSS and you, who's the husband and who's the wife. But that apart, Dr. Swamy, what I wanted to know was not so much whether RSS took umbrage or not, and we'll come to why you're in the position you're today. I just wanted to understand what was the idea of India that you espoused then? What is it that you were batting for?
Well, I still would say that we can never be a theocratic state, nor we were ever, except during the Buddhist period and the Mughal period. These are the only two periods when India was a theocratic state. And the Indian history, our Hindu history as you might call it, has examples like the Parsis who came to India and have lived without ever even facing discrimination, so much so when the British left India, they tried to seduce them for a reservation for them, like they did for Anglo-Indians. And they flatly said that for 1,000 years, the Hindus have looked after us, and we don't need you. Same thing with Jews. They were persecuted all over the world. The only country where they never received any persecution was India. And we built their synagogues. They're still there in Cochin and Bombay. And the Israeli parliament, one of the first resolutions they passed was to thank India that you are the only country which didn't persecute the Jews. So the Hindu tradition, which recognizes all paths lead to God, the only religion which says that, if it is practiced that way, then you can never be a theocratic state where you say Hindu and nothing but Hindu. So in that sense, there's no contradiction between that view of that India can't be a theocratic state and what I'm saying now. I think there is sometimes evolution as over time. I think certainly the Islamic terror has made a lot of difference in the world as to how we see the other religions and what we should do to protect ourselves. And in that context, my ideas have evolved. And I have now a clearly stated position.
So, you know, Dr. Swamy, of course, your positions now are extremely public. And a large part of that is aimed indeed at, you know, at Muslims acknowledging, for instance, yeah. Of course, there's the famous or infamous, depends on which side of the divide one stands on, your DNA piece, where yes. You said all Muslims should be disenfranchised unless they accept their Hindu ancestry.
That's right.
You know, when you just spoke of India, it's true that that civilizational impulse runs through our country. Our constitution has declared us to be plural, and it is in any case playing itself out. What is it that you hope to achieve by making Muslims say that they have had a Hindu ancestry? Even if they all declared that, what would you achieve by that?
Well, first of all, it's the scientific truth. Because the DNA studies, genetic studies, show that the Hindus and Muslims have the same DNA. In fact, North Indian, South Indian, East Indian, West Indian also have the same DNA. Brahmins and scheduled caste also have the same DNA. So this whole British construct of Aryans and Dravidians and invaders, it's all bogus. We have been one people throughout history. Now, when a Muslim acknowledges that his ancestors are Hindus, and which is the scientific truth, in a sense he becomes as much an owner of this land as anybody else, in the sense of cultural sense. And that creates also a family atmosphere, that these people's ancestors are the same as mine. It's when the Muslim identifies with Ghori and Ghazni that the divide starts coming. And I think, frankly, privately, all Muslims, especially educated Muslims, tell me that what I'm saying is correct. In fact, Farooq Abdullah, if he's coming here, you ask him, he told me that my ancestors are Gaud Saraswatam Brahmins. And I said, why don't you say it publicly? He said, are you mad? The mullah will kill me. So that is the issue. I'm seeking the way of uniting. And the Hindu-Muslim divide is one of the most debilitating aspects of our society. And to bring them together, we have to find commonality. And this is a scientific commonality. And that should be accepted.
Before we move to other things, just to contest a little bit of what you've said.
You can ask what you like. I give as good as I get.
I haven't started giving yet. But would you accept that Alexander the Great was Greek? Would you accept
yes,
that?
Yes, I accept he's Greek, but he never came to India.
He left some of his Greek generals behind. Some of our ancestry is from the Greek generals.
No.
Some of it is from the Persians.
It's all Ramila Thapar. You've been brainwashed by Ramila Thapar.
Well, as also some Hollywood movies.
There's also no truth. There's no truth in Alexander coming to India. He came on the borders. He was defeated. And he was heartbroken and died on his way in Persia. All these, this Plutarch, you see, was accompanying historians. They're all gas bags, you see. The Greek writers are all always telling lies. I don't think we should. There's no reference in anything. The Puranas, for example, on whom even the British historians, who distort our history, they rely on. How do you know that Ashoka was the son of Bindusara? It's there in the Puranas. They don't have any independent evidence. So according to Puranas, which recorded our history, there is no reference whatsoever to Alexander.
So, you know, again, these are questions that will lead us down 5 hours of debate. So
sure.
I'm going to let it lie at that. With Romila Thapar.
You're surrendering, right?
I'm not surrendering. I'm not surrendering, only delaying our conversation.
Right.
We'll have you back for part two.
Sure.
But when I have you back for part two, I'm going to have the best genetic scientist with us. And we'll ask whether the Dravidians and the Aryans are really the same race.
Yeah.
But that apart, partly why this tension arises is because the construct of being or accepting that one is Hindu is a mischievous one, because when it is articulated in modern India, it is by a sleight of hand asking Muslims to somehow accept their Hinduism rather than their Hinduness, which really was a geographical and civilizational construct that everybody west of the east of the Indus belonged to a Hindu country, which was a geographical construct. But it is not really posited like that. It is somehow to accept that you are somewhat second-class citizens, that you are, that you converted, and that your true origin and your true genius lies with Hindus. Would you accept that if you phrase this differently, people might find it less problematic?
Well, maybe you can give me a formulation. I'll consider it, but...
This is the most humble I've ever seen you on stage.
Well, the sting is yet to come. See, the issue is this, when you want to wake up somebody, sometimes you have to jolt them. It's rude, but that's the only way. Today, if I put it in this way, a debate follows, and out of that, a synthesis comes. There's no inherent hatred in me for anybody, because my wife is a Parsi, my son-in-law is a Muslim, I have a sister-in-law who's Christian, and I have a brother-in-law who's a Jew. And to date, I have never heard them say I'm communal. I've heard you say, or Telka say, or whatever your successor publications are. But I am not at all of the view of Hindu supremacy, because it will be inconsistent with Hindus. Because when you say all paths lead to God, How can you be supremacist? Yes, the Bible says only my way or the highway. And the Muslims say, if you are not a believer in Allah, then you are a kafir. And there is a special treatment for kafirs. So it, of course, varies from ISIS to other places. But still, you see, Pakistan had 21% Hindus today as 1%. Bangladesh had 33% Hindus today, it is 7%. But here, the Muslim population is a much higher proportion than it was in 1947. See, this country is innately a tolerant country. I don't like this word tolerant because people have, you know, sullied its meaning in the recent days. But the fact is that we accept there are other ways, and our shlokas are there plenty which show that we accept the whole world as something that is ours. So I would say the formulation, the Muslims can have a debate with me and tell me that this is the formulation we can accept. I'm not saying that just because you are descended from Hindus, therefore you have to become like Hindus or you have to become Hindus. But you can have culture almost the same. For instance, today the Parsis, I can't distinguish them from other Hindus. They wear clothes like the Hindus, I mean the traditional Parsis. They speak Gujarati. They're well versed with all our festivals. They participate in our festivals. This separateness which is being fed by these monks, these clerics, that is what I'm combating.
But in fact, Swami, that brings us back to this point. You know, Everything that you're saying shows that the principle of unity already exists in this country.
Yes, yes, yes.
We have 180 million Muslims.
Yes.
And like you said, you know, all the other countries.
I don't know if it's 180, but around,
but somewhat average. But all the
plus
other
minus 30.
30 as in just 30 or 30 million?
30 million, yeah.
Well, we that takes us to another memory of hum paanch, hum pachis, all of that. So let's not get into that. But, you know, all the other countries that you described are indeed majoritarian nations. The genius of this country is its plurality.
Yeah, yeah.
Everything that you've described, again, shows that that principle is already at play.
Yeah.
So what set you off in the search for an artificial articulation of unity, which already exists? It runs in our blood, as you said, and barring the great rupture of partition, Indian Muslims have continued to live in great harmony in this country. There may be riots, but when you look at the sheer number, even with all the Islamist unrest across the world, you can count on your fingers the number of young boys that may have got involved with terror cells. So why are we trying to alienate an entire community with this kind of crude articulation?
Well, I think they should not get alienated. They should call for a discussion. It should be
the question or the answer.
I would say, see, when a community refuses to accept facts, then the problem arises for people like me. Now, I'll give you an example. I'm dealing with this Ram temple matter. Now, the faith of the Hindus is that Ram was born in a particular place. Science has now proved that is archaeological survey of India's work, court supervised by the Allahabad High Court, has proved that there was a temple pre-existing, which was demolished. And on that, a mosque was built. Now, a mob went and demolished that masjid, for which a criminal case is going on. Now, if you look at the status of a mosque in, say, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Qatar, all the way to Iran, including Pakistan, they say, and it is part of the Islamic theology, that a masjid is only a facilitation center for reading namaz. And namaz can be read anywhere. So if you go to Google and type mosques demolished in Saudi Arabia or Iran or Pakistan, whatever, you will get a list of prominent mosques which have been demolished by the state. For example, for building roads, they have demolished mosques in Saudi Arabia. the mosque built on the direction of Prophet Muhammad in Makkah was also demolished by the Saudi Arabian government. UNESCO protested, and they wrote back to the UNESCO that you are trying to teach us what they call as idol worship. There's nothing sacred about Muhammad building a mosque, because mosque is for reading namaz. Namaz can be read anywhere. So the principle that a mosque can be shifted, authorizedly, not unauthorizedly, or it could be demolished, is an accepted principle of Islam all over in all Islamic countries. Now, what is the difficulty for a Muslim, for the Muslims of India to say that, yes, we want a mosque, you give us another place? And we have actually designated place across the Saryu River. And this, you see, is where we believe as faith Ram was born. I can build a mosque anywhere else, but I can't build a Ram Lala Mandir anywhere else, because except in the place of birth. So why can't the Muslim community say, as a compromise, you build us another mosque and you have your Ram temple here? And they're not very far. Across the Saryu River is not very far. But this determination, no, it will be there. When you know already there is a temple which has been certified by the Allahabad High Court, now what kind of attitude is this? What can I do to persuade them? The Supreme Court Chief Justice tells me, I'm willing to negotiate. I'm going to tell him on 31st. I've talked to all of them. All of them have now come to the view that they know that we mean business, we are going to do it anyway. Either my way or the highway. So therefore, they have said, now let the Supreme Court give an order and we'll accept it. I'm saying, for a simple thing like this, 40,000 temples were demolished. We are not saying all should be returned. We are only saying that there are only three: Krishna temple in Mathura, Kashi Vishwanath in Varanasi, and this one. I think the Muslim community should, since a mosque is only a place for reading namaz, namaz can be read on the road, can be read in your drawing room, can be read in an aeroplane, and they do so. Why can't they accommodate this wish of the Hindus?
You know, it seems a rational proposition, what you're saying. Do you think it comes back to the problem of articulation? That, like you said, it is articulated with a desire to disrupt rather than to persuade. And it is, and you are, if you sounded as you are sounding on this algebra stage, then, you know, I'm sure many people wouldn't find it hard to stomach that. That's one point. And the second is, it's not just you, I'm not just talking about you, but the entire axis of the Hindutva right does it as an act of dominance, you know, rather than of persuasion.
Yeah,
and of
right. I'll deal with that point. First of all, let me tell you that OYC told me that you're the most dangerous Hindu I've met. I said, why? He said, you're so articulate. In fact, they think I am a bigger danger because I might fool the Muslims into agreeing with me and that sort of thing. They would prefer somebody who's, you know, screaming away with a trishul than a person like me. But articulation is on the process, but there are so many vested interests. You'd be surprised to know that two of the most hardline Muslim parties in the Ram temple are not asking for a mosque. They say, this is our property. And how is it your property? It was originally, Hindus were there before Muslims. They say, yes, it was Hindu property, but we captured it, and by adverse possession, it has become ours. Now, I can't understand. They are not fighting for a masjid at all. It's not a question of one religious demand versus another religious demand. Here somebody says, this is my property. So I think it's easy to say articulation. I'm ready to be articulate. With my son-in-law, I'm very articulate. And he's already been brainwashed by me, as they say.
But Dr. Swamy, why would you... We'll move on. There are just a couple of points I'd like to make. One, why would you not extend that courtesy to your public life? You know, the way you speak to Mr. Haider should be how you speak to the public, is one point. The other is that, again, the mistake that I think all Indian politicians make, yeah, is to speak to Muslim clerics. Much like the Hindu right doesn't represent the Hindu, the Muslim clerics don't represent the Muslims of India, and we're really only speaking to the most bigoted always. And the third point is that partly why today the Ram Mandir has become a point of distress is because thousands of car sevaks got onto it and broke it down. And yeah. So it has become a symbol of violence and dominance rather than of persuasion, you know.
See, people commit crimes, they have to be prosecuted, and in this case, they are being prosecuted. You can't hold the whole Hindu community responsible for it. Many of us, in fact, at that time, you didn't quote me, I had condemned this act. I said, this is not the way we're going to do it. Because at that time, Chandrasekhar was prime minister, I was the minister of law. And we were the ones who were negotiating with Mr. Shahabuddin. We had almost come to a settlement. Then, unfortunately, our government fell and Mr. Narasimha Rao's government came and this happened. The issue is this, you see. You are using Hindu right, Hindu fanatic, everybody in with one brush, you see. The fact is that the Hindu right is very articulate. I'm ready to debate with any. In fact, you find that most people in these channels, they want me and OIC together because he's a hardline Muslim, I'm a hardline Hindu, apparently. And both of us have a very civilized debate. And I think that process should go on. I think, first of all, I think of Hindu Muslims as my blood brothers because the DNA says so. But I can't make them forget their history. We have been through a long series of butchery, destruction. I'm not holding them responsible, but they should also not identify with them. Nobody should identify with Aurangzeb. How many people protested when we changed the name of Aurangzeb Road to Dr. Abdul Kalam's name? So that mindset, I must take you back a little in history. Please don't misunderstand what I'm telling you, but this is historical fact. The British, when they created India and Pakistan, there was only India, there was no Pakistan, so they had to create a legal fiction. So they had a bill passed in the House of Commons called the Indian Independence Act. And that Indian Independence Act, the debate, if you read, speaker after speaker, including the Prime Minister, says, our object is to create a Muslim-governed Pakistan and a Hindu-governed India. Ambedkar pounced on that, the man who was the chairman of the drafting committee, and said, let's have population exchange. But the rest of the leadership of the Congress said, no. If the Muslims who want to stay in India are welcome to stay in India. This is something we have never questioned. And on the other hand, Pakistan has become a theocratic country. Nobody wants, even now the Pakistani civil society is admiring our society. They wonder why we can't have, Pakistan can't have what we have. So my job is shock and awe, but at the same time make them rethink. And I think we have come a long way. Don't say we are a fringe group because now we are getting sweeping election victories. Mr. Modi, I have convinced him that nobody has won an election on governance. Narasimha Rao produced the best governance. Narasimha Rao produced the best governance in our history. Growth rate went from 3.5% to 9%. And his party was such a badly defeated party that he got half the number of seats. Mr. Vajpayee, who was all your liberal hero, a hero to all your liberals.
Well, not quite mine. But okay. That's another piece of history, but we'll come to that.
So he talked about India shining, and internally our cadre and all disliked him intensely, but he couldn't win. In fact, he advanced the election thinking he would win because he believed journalists like you see that we are going to win. And he advanced the election by 6 months and we lost. Morarji Desai produced the best price inflation control in the history of India. And he was badly defeated. In this country, when an election is there, like in most countries, like it has recently happened in America, it's emotion that counts. But you've got to be careful with emotion because there are countries which emotions got out of hand, like Germany in the 20s and 30s. We must be in the control of the hardline elements. And today I can say with firmness, with confidence, that many of us in the BJP can any day control these fanatics and keep them in their place whenever we want.
Are you then saying When you make that assertion, are you saying that Muzaffarnagar happened with intention, that you did not want to control Muzaffarnagar? Are you saying then that Gujarat happened with intention? You did not want to control it?
First of all, what happened in Muzaffarnagar and what happened in Gujarat is not what you think had happened. I'm willing to have a separate debate on that. Because I've collected the data on it, and I can prove to you. And you see, for all this media campaign, no court. In fact, even the UP government has not filed a case. That is the Akhilesh government. So, the same thing with Gujarat. Yes, the burning of those 56 women and children in Godhra had put the people mad, but it lasted only 2 days. It was brought under control. And the true picture is something different from what the media has been portraying. This is my opinion. I'm willing to debate with the media. But the media doesn't like me very much, so they don't invite me for such debates. But I am telling you, don't please go by these events. And certainly, I don't think it is instigated by us in any of these events.
I declare that we start a Swami series of evenings if all of you are game. And I'll invite you again and again for debate, sir. But that apart, I'm not going to, again, pursue some of these because they require much more substantive conversations. Yes, I do disagree, but fact-based. You just said that a lot of political life is based on emotions, elections is based on emotions. I'd like to hope that journalism is based on evidence, or should be at least.
Yeah, of course.
And so, but that's another debate. You did mention that you've convinced Mr. Modi that since we are sweeping election after election, you didn't come to the heart of it. What have you convinced him about?
I told him that governance alone is not...
Governance isn't enough. He should play the Hindutva card.
Governance or good government is a necessary condition, but not a sufficient condition. For sufficient condition, you need some emotional appeal where your worker starts working and he goes around to booths and so on. That is where we have to have both. On the other hand, if you have no governance at all, you will be defeated.
But
you have to have good governance. But at the same time, that's not enough.
But Dr. Swamy, may I ask why both of you, inspirational demagogues, good talkers, orators, both Mr. Modi and you, why would you not use that particular skill to rouse emotion in an inspirational way? Why would you use it to rouse destructive emotion?
Well, I think you should come around and see the meetings I'm addressing. I have never roused any passions. The crowds that attend my meetings are all highly educated professionals. I go to the United States, where there's a very severe watch on all people on what kind of hate speeches they give. And the Indian crowds are, you know, massive. In fact, New York Times reported that it is I who supported Trump. And the Indians, for the first time, broke from Democratic parties, Democratic Party to the Republican. I don't think that this is wrong. This is, in my opinion, wrong. It is not correct to say that we do not tell the people the enlightened view of our history. We think that the British distorted our history to make you feel inferior, and now we are giving them a sense of pride. In that, we take care to see that this sense of pride doesn't go out of hand. It can go out of hand, as I told you about Germany, it went out of hand. But at the same time, I would ask the intellectuals not to typecast this, argue with us and tell us where we are wrong. But I have seen nothing but distortion of what you say. And the media distortions is unbelievable. Once I explained in Banaras University, audience, that Ravan was a Brahmin. And yet, a Kshatriya killed him. And people didn't say, oh, a Kshatriya killed a Brahmin. They worship Rama, including the Brahmins. Now, what is the Times of India, right? That Swami said that Raman was a Dalit and that's why he assaulted Sita. Now, of course, I sent them a legal notice and they got chicken, but they published a small correction. How do you correct the media which is out to sensationalize what you say?
Well, you've got me hamstrung there, yeah, because I'm sort of stammering because I can't defend the media on many, many counts.
You can do what is called as prayaschit.
Prayaschit. I accept that generically I think all professions, both politicians and journalists, are letting down our core ethics, and that brings both you and me to the prayaschit corner. But Dr. Swamy, to move on, I'll just remind ourselves that there's one question we didn't quite address, but there's so much more to talk about, that I had asked you why in a country that is largely in harmony and living in plurality, why is there this search for an artificial unity? We didn't quite address that question. Yeah. If we have time, we'll come back to it.
Yeah. I don't mind addressing it in short.
Okay.
So far, now I'm giving you an answer as a politician. Okay. So far, we have been finding that the Hindus are being divided and the minorities are being united. And that gives the minorities a disproportionate share in the voting in the country. What we have done is, by this Hindutva, is to make everybody feel that he is an equal Hindu. Not 80%, we have not reached that level, but we have climbed from what we were once upon a time of 18% and 17%, now we've gone to 33%, and that is giving us majority. Next election, if we go to 40%, we get 2/3 majority. And if we get 80%, then we'll get all the seats. There'll be nobody to contest against us. So, as far as this pan-Hindu identity, it meets a historic attempt to divide the country into Aryans, Dravidians, Brahmins, this thing. You see, these Brahmin, Kshatriya, etc., was never meant to be birth-based. It was on the division of labor. That the Brahmins will pursue education, the Kshatriyas will defend the country, the Vaishyas would...
But in 2017, do you think that is really the most urgent agenda, to unify Hindus against Muslims?
Not against Muslims. Now...
No, I'm asking, because when you say that
it's
you're...
It's in her blood to be a journalist, so she has to...
No, there is an inference, and you being a mathematician will know that when you put X plus Y, there will be two, you know?
At no space, at any time, I have thought that the Hindutva movement should be directed against anybody except ourselves. In fact, I admire the Muslim community for its clarity of mind. Where they are a majority, they don't give you any rights at all. You go and try and build a temple in Saudi Arabia, they'll kill you. You go in Kashmir, where the Muslims are in majority, see what the plight of the Hindus is. 500,000 Hindus were driven out from there. Nobody even wants to talk about it. Go to Kerala in Malappuram, see how the Muslims treat the Hindus there.
So are you saying that you really admire this and you want to transform the greatness of Hindu culture into the Islamist ideal?
I am saying that the Muslims are very clear. When they are in power, they won't allow anybody else to survive. They are clear. But that clarity I don't want. I'm only saying, please don't feel sorry for any community. Must know their characteristics. They are where they are in majority, they don't allow any person. And on the other hand, where the majority is determined, non-Muslim majority is determined, they surrender. Take Australia. They accept uniform civil code there. They accept all the rules. You can't wear a burqa. They accept that. Can I do that in India? They will never have triple talaq in Australia. But in India, we have to fight every inch of the way. For a matter which is a straight gender equality. So don't say this thing is where you're trying to target a Muslim. I'm not targeting a Muslim. If at all, I'm telling them, see, the Muslims are so powerful because they're united. You are not united. You are divided in all these silly
divisions. But you know, Dr. Swamy, one can be persuaded by this, but you do know that there are many potholes in what you're saying.
Agreed.
The BJP did not give a single Muslim a ticket. Yeah. So when you're saying, I understand that you want to consolidate the Hindu vote for electoral purposes, but that Sabka Hath, Sabka Vikas goes down the drain when you want to create a Hindu consolidation because you assume there is a Muslim consolidation. I just wanted to challenge that very slightly with one fact which I'd like to share with the audience, which is that Indian Muslims, I'm not speaking for Muslims elsewhere in the world, I feel extremely proud of Muslims in India because I think they have repeatedly, under great duress, showed that they are Indians first and that religion is a private affair. And I'd like to share with this audience that it is fascinating that in India, no pure Muslim party has ever got even 1% of the vote. They have continued to believe in the democratic mainstream, and there is Itar King in Assam, he's never got the vote. Mr. Owesi has never got much of the vote. Any party that has positioned themselves as a Muslim party has never got the vote. And so I'd like to challenge your assumption
on
that.
Let's put it the other way around. Supposing it was a Muslim majority society as opposed to a Hindu majority society, do you think the Hindu minority would have got the same kind of facility which the Muslims in India have? Can they contest elections in Saudi Arabia,
I think,
or in Pakistan or even in Bangladesh?
Dr. Swamy, I think part of the sadness of this entire cultural conversation
is
that we try to push each other into corners.
Sure.
The point of the beauty of India...
You push me, I'll push you.
Yes. But I'm pushing you on evidence. At no point have I set myself up as a spokesman for Muslims. I think I'm a spokesman for the plurality of India. When you say that if this had been a Muslim majority... It is not a Muslim majority.
The plurality of India is a Hindu phenomenon, not a Muslim phenomenon.
Yes. Dr. Swamy, I actually perhaps accept that. In fact, we had Mr. Saeed Naqvi here speaking a few weeks ago, and he made a very interesting proposition. He said that in many ways, partition was a terrible rupture, even for Muslims, because that encounter between Islam and the Hindu civilization created a new force, which would have been a force for modernity, rather than, a lot of Islam is also rooted in desert culture, and that is its own battle that it has to fight. But I'm coming back to India, where when you say that if it had been a Muslim majority, I'm saying the beauty of this country is that it's not. The constitution declares us to be a plural society. Perhaps the Hindu genius runs in its blood, but it runs nascently, incipiently, and permanently. By trying to turn it into that majoritarian language, in fact, you're mutilating the genius of this civilization.
I agree with that. I'm not turning it into a majoritarian.
Wow, from tomorrow you're going to speak differently.
No. I'm only telling the Hindus, your innate strength is that you are a continuing civilization because you have stood against everybody. You know, Islam conquered Iran. How many years it took it to convert to 100% Muslim? 15 years. Mesopotamia, Babylon, which are now together called Iraq, they did it in 17 years. This Egypt, 21 years. Christians converted Europe in 50 years. This country has had 800 years of Muslim rule, 200 years of Christian rule, and you're still 80% Hindu. It is because of the resilience of the Hindu people.
But live in peace with that.
Not because of the lack of atrocities that were committed by them. Now, that is innate in us. But at the same time, I'm saying, don't let this put your guard down. Prithviraj Chauhan was a great fighter. He defeated Muhammad Ghori how many times? There are different accounts. Somebody says 16, 14, 3, etc. But he's repeatedly defeated him, forgave him, and sent him away. And he came back. Finally, he won. That kind of foolishness, I don't want Hindus to commit today.
Dr. Swamy, we'll move away because there's so many other interesting conversations to have with you. Again, I'm going to use the moderator's prerogative to quickly share two stories. One that a wonderful historian called Richard Eaton has documented how many Hindu kings demolished Hindu temples, because that was the medieval logic. It was domination. When we try to interpret modern political contemporary history through the lens of medieval history, that therein lies the problem. And the other story that we often are never told, neither by our public figures nor by our history books, is a little detail that I as an adult only got to know barely a year ago, which is that we are often told about Aurangzeb. But Aurangzeb had a son called Akbar, not the grand Akbar, but a son called Akbar, who actually fought with Shivaji against Aurangzeb, against his own father. Now that's a story that we are not often told. So like everything, history, Muslims, Hindus, they were all anecdotal, they were all individual. Yes, we were dominated for 800 years, but that was a circumstance of history. And Hindus collaborated in that dominance and fought each other, you know. But to interpret 2017 through 16th century history seems an intellectual failure.
Wrong to say that a bland statement that Hindus collaborated in that. Not at all. Shivaji did not collaborate.
I said some Hindu kings.
That you will have,
like some Muslim kings were one way, some were not.
No, no. You know? After all, when the 1857 revolt took place, it was a Hindu revolt, but we made a Muslim as the Bahadur Shah Zafar, as the king of India. So, I mean, it's not, these are not the issues. The issue is that we were invaded, we were looted, a lot of our people suffered great deal of humiliation, particularly women. And there are documented history stories. I don't want to remember all of them. But I do want to say that this should never happen again. And for that, there is a common Hindu identity, which we always had. For instance, Mahabharata, all the kings, over 1,000, 3,000 kings from different parts of India came to Kurukshetra to fight on both sides. And when Rama went to Sri Lanka, in Kishkinda when he came, that is in Karnataka, his brother Lakshmana objected to making monkeys as part of his army. And he said, they are residents of this area. How can I bring my army from Ayodhya? And this identification with all parts of India as yours has been always our continuing tradition. That is what I am trying to argue. Now, if the Muslims also accept that their ancestors are Hindus, then we are brothers and sisters.
This is called the persistence of the great mathematician. I'm going to move away, Dr. Swamy.
Please, please.
Because
this is an unending conversation.
I wish it would end, actually. But, you know, I just want to just end
there's
again.
One
because
way of
I know.
End. There's
I
one think way of ending. You convert to my point of view.
I just told you the pity of it, the pity of this, Dr. Swamy, is that such a absorbent, such a self-confident culture is trying to become knee-jerk and dominant, you know. It should just play itself out as it has for millennia. I'd just like to end with one thing, which actually, I know that you're an intellectual, and sometimes the intellectual and the politician in you are at war, but I'm going to appeal to the intellectual in you. That when you said that there has been 800 years of brutish Muslim rule in many ways, you know, invasion, destruction, let's remind ourselves that King Ashoka was the epitome of the Hindu king.
No,
and he went to,
he was a Buddhist king.
He became Buddhist after Kalinga. He became Buddhist after the Kalinga massacre. Kalinga was in Odisha, in Orissa. It was a Hindu king massacring Hindus, and he transformed to a Buddhist king after that. So that idea of medieval violence is just medieval violence. It's nothing else. Let's move away, Dr. Okay. Swamy. Let's move away to why a man of your intellect and academic training. Before that, I'd just like to ask you one more thing. When you mentioned your family and how plural it is, you once said something very interesting to Abhinandan Sekri, who's the editor of News Laundry. You said you yourself never go to temples except for political reasons.
Yeah.
And you also told another student of yours, Javed Bukri, if I'm not mistaken, Shahid Javed Bukri.
Barki.
Pakistani, very dear friend of Dr. Swamy's. Yeah. Dr. Swamy said, you're going to now watch me here say a lot of things about Islam and Muslims that you may not like, but I don't really mean it. It is political things that I'm saying. Yeah. Dr. Swamy, that's background checking by a journalist.
Wait till I meet Barki again.
So please tell me, everything that you say, is it really something that you emotionally believe, or is this political expedience? And we all know that hell hath no scorn, hell hath no fury, like Swami scorned. Yeah. And we'd like to know the story of who scorned you and brought you to this moment.
I won't say that because of scorn that I'm what I am. There was a certain element, because my mother was a staunch Hindu. That's how it began. And a sense of nationalism where I defended the country. And I found many of these things like this Aryan Dravidian theory and the way the caste, the Varna system was portrayed, etc. When I started reading deeper, I began to feel that this is being foisted on us to weaken us. That's how the process began. It is true that the determination to find an alternative to the Jawaharlal Nehru type of ideology began with the dishonest treatment of me after I returned from Harvard. Now you see, at Harvard, I have the record for the shortest period in history, in their history, because you can't get it less than, in 6 months I got cleared my general exam. I was a joint author with Paul Samuelson. And his entire life, I don't think he collaborated with more than five people. He was a great, he's the Einstein of economics. I was a student, my thesis advisor was Paul Simon Kuznets, who's another great Nobel laureate. And I had research publications which are already become famous. My work on China, even today, is a compulsory reading in most universities. And I came back at the invitation of people here to teach in India. And I was singled out for the fact that I was not left-wing. I was never left-wing, because you have to be a bit crazy to be left-wing. And I was targeted.
I'd just like to share with the audience that Dr. Swamy's father was left-wing. He was a Marxist.
My father was a left-wing, yes. But I told you my mother was not, so. Now,
Bharat Mata
ki jai. You do not know what I went through. I came at the invitation of Mr. Amartya Sen to become professor of Chinese studies at the Delhi School of Economics. I land here, the political climate had changed because Congress Party split and the communists became partners of Mrs. Gandhi. And the same Amartya Sen who wrote me a letter asking me to come, saying that your gaddi is being dusted in his own hand. That letter I've still got. And upon arrival, he says, you see, times have changed, your ideology is, you know, you're anti-socialist, etc. And I was denied a professorship, for which I left my teaching career at Harvard to come back. They were expecting that I would go back to Harvard, which is what most Indians were doing in those days. Then I became professor at IIT, thanks to Manmohan Singh, who was the chairman of the selection committee. And he immediately invited me without my even appearing for an interview. And I became professor. I was a very successful professor because I was teaching mathematical economics to IIT students who loved it. And I produced very good students. One of them has ended up in jail, however, that Rajat Gupta. And then Harvard made a contract with me that I should come every year to teach at least in one semester. And the most convenient semester for me was the summer, which is only is a compressed six weeks or 2 months semester. So I used to go regularly teach at Harvard. Now, suddenly one day, Mrs. Gandhi picks up my book, Indian Economic Planning and Alternative Approach, and reads in the parliament, saying this man says, if you give up socialism, our growth rate will go up from 3.5% to 10%, and that we can produce the atom bomb. that we don't need foreign aid from foreign governments. What kind of propagation is this? Such a person is a professor, and that too a full professor. So 2 days later, I was sacked from IIT. And a one-line letter. I mean, I'm permanent. Now, nobody to stand up for me. And then I thought I'll apply for jobs elsewhere. I applied for Dibrugarh University, thinking that nobody will want to go to Dibrugarh University. Even that I was turned down. So ultimately, the only thing left for me is to go to politics or to leave India and go back to Harvard, which is what my professors wanted me to do. I stayed on here. And then, of course, my papers and my writings became public. And then RSS one day turned up in my house and said, you talk our language, and how come we don't know you? I've never been a member of RSS. So they took me, they made me a member of parliament. And then the emergency came, and then everything transformed. So I have this view that these people who give me lectures on tolerance are the most intolerant people. There's no doubt that I would have been crushed otherwise. So it's a question of my tolerance versus your tolerance.
Actually, Dr. Swamy, I'm in total agreement with you. And, you know, there's more to this history of how an extremely intelligent 24-year-old, 27-year-old from Harvard is really rejected by the entire intellectual establishment here because your ideas didn't fit in. But I think the cruel irony, the twisted irony of all that, Dr. Swamy, is that today, instead of then becoming a fiery crusader for intellectual openness, you basically went over to the other side, which also pushes for intellectual shutdown. And today, you are part of a party and a part of a political establishment that sets the most uninformed people in the censor board. You know, much like you said that the Congress had infiltrated every institution, today you're part of an RSS and BJP that is infiltrating every institution and outlawing all intellectual openness. Yeah. Isn't that a terrible irony?
For the time being, this is necessary to correct the imbalance that you created.
When you say, Dr. Swamy, a man as intelligent as you possibly understands that there's a middle position. Yeah. When one critiques the BJP, it doesn't make one a Congress sympathizer. I detest what the Congress is doing in this country today. Yeah. Yes, I believed in some of the foundational values of that party.
Yes.
But criticizing a government in power doesn't necessarily make you a spokesperson for the opposition.
No, I said that in the 1970s when this happened to me. That time you were quite silent. You were probably not born, I don't know. But the fact is...
This is called pulling
today,
rank.
The fact is, I am very conscious of what you're saying. But I think that this restoration of balance has to be done by the process which you disapprove. There's no other way. I cannot allow Mr. Amartya Sen to be the chancellor of Nalanda University because he is populating them with communists. So I have to correct that by sending him off. He's, of course, a bit sore with Modi, but Modi is not really the person responsible. It's I who's taking revenge. But that rectification will go up to a point, and it will not go beyond a point because we have in many places rectified it by bringing very brilliant people also. And I agree with you that we have populated the censor board with people who you would not have coffee with. But the fact is I am enjoying that.
You're enjoying that?
Yes, because you lauded it over. Now it's my turn
you're
to lord it over.
You're using me as a... Dr. Swamy, I've never felt a larger and more eloquent metaphor than in your presence. You know? But I just want to share with you that I don't know if in that laughter you noticed that Dr. Swamy said that I'm taking revenge. And he has a friend called Mr. Nalapat, who's part of the RSS. Yes. And he said so much of what Dr. Swamy is doing in his public life is driven by a sense of revenge. And that's a pity. But he also used a wonderful phrase. He said he has a... In the sector of revenge, he's a Sicilian. He has a Sicilian sense of revenge.
That, by the way, is not his originality. It is Mrs. Sonia Gandhi who told me. And I'm telling you, she told me. And she's now knowing what a real Sicilian is.
Well, I'm going to, you know, we're running out of time, and there are just one or two really important things that we can't let Mr. Swamy go without speaking of. I'd just like to quickly run through his life. He was enemies with Mrs. Indira Gandhi, then briefly friends with Mrs. Indira Gandhi. Yeah. He was good friend with Rajiv Gandhi. I already mentioned he was friends with Jayalalitha, then not friends with Jayalalitha, then he was friends with, never friends with, no, initially friends with Vajpayee, then never friends with Vajpayee. And so the story goes on. With Chidambaram, of course, who began to investigate his involvement in the Chandraswamy Trust, and that's a sore point that Mr. Chidambaram is also learning, the beauty of Sicilian revenge. So all of that, of course, continues.
You must visit him in Tiar when he goes there very soon.
But, Dr. Swamy, I think all of us, unlike some of my compatriots in the media, I can't speak for the nation, and I can't speak even for Algebra Club members. But I can speak, I think, for myself and perhaps intuitively for this audience, is to say that if your acts of revenge were only personal ones, which only had personal impacts, it would have been all good. But when a man like you plays his Shakespearean level of revenge out on such public platform and begins to espouse views that he doesn't actually believe in,
No.
You're pushing the civilization, you're pushing the country into spaces that it does not want to go.
First of all, I only take revenge against those who misuse power against me. Because I'll give you an example. I'll give you the example. When Harvard, with all these left-wing loonies got together and decided that...
Your father's spirit must be turning in its grave, you know.
Yes, it's true. Deleted my course from being given the following year. I was actually happy because they made me heroes in the Hindutva crowd. Because I'd been removed for this article on DNA. But there was one person who didn't misuse the power but supported the Harvard deletion of my courses and sending me back home. And that was she. And I never held it against
me.
You. You came
I've
on NDTV with me and fully supported what Harvard did to me. But I don't hold it against you because you didn't use your power. You didn't use the power of the state to harm me. So I am very...
Thanks be to God.
Therefore, I have never held it against somebody who is had a difference of opinion, criticized me. I mean, I shouldn't be saying this myself, that my enemies should say that, but I have only targeted people who have been in power or have misused power. And I fought them when they were in power. It's not that I fought them when they were not in power. I fought Mr. Chidambaram when he was finance minister. And he thought of every possible way to send me to jail and failed. Now I'm going to teach him how to send anybody to jail very soon.
Okay. We're going to leave Mr. Chidambaram to his devices. I'm going to quickly bivouac to Yogi Adityanath. Yogi Adityanath has the choice of Yogi Adityanath as a CM has dismayed many,
yes,
many people, including supporters of the BJP.
Yeah, it makes me happy.
Okay. As we said, you know, Dr. Swamy, that you're playing your revenge out by occupying exactly those positions of power that you detested in others. You're playing out power in exactly the same ways that you detested. And that's a bit of a disappointment from someone like you. But I would like to put two, three questions to you where Yogi Adityanath is concerned.
Yeah.
One, that why would a man like you, you know, everything that you've said here today is that it's in defense of civilizational values, etc. Yogi Adityanath is somebody who stood on stage and said, if they hurt one Hindu, we'll kill 100. If they steal one of our daughters, we'll steal 100. This is taking the principle of destructive retaliation to another level. He is a man who believes that being homosexual is equal to being a beast. I know you don't like homosexuality either, but this is, again, articulation of the crudest forms.
I only consider it as a biological disorder.
Well, you all people can evolve, but we'll leave it at that.
Okay.
But at least your articulation is less crude than a man who says this doesn't separate a beast from a man.
Yeah.
He is somebody who believes that women should be kept at home, and because the santulan of the house would be shaken if the woman went out to work, and many other things that Yogi Adityanath does and says. Why would you, in defense of Hinduism, put a man like that as the head of the largest state in India?
Sure.
First question, why would a man like you defend him? Third question, if the BJP feels that it is a man like him that majority Hindus are voting for, why did they not declare him as the UPCM candidate? Instead, Mr. Modi went around speaking of Sabka Hath, Sabka Vikas, and then you go and put a really divisionary figure as the CM. That's really betraying the mandate. Would you agree to all of this?
No, I don't agree to anything. First of
all, your nodding of your head had me jubilating.
I said, go on. If Adityanath implements all the things that you said, he has said. I've not heard him say that to me, but I've not read also what this particular thing. You are, of course, in the profession where you follow things very much more closely of what politicians say and don't say. But the fact is, if he implements it, I'll be the first one to stand up against it. I'll give you a small example.
That's on record.
Yeah, absolutely on record. I'll give you a small example. This Sabarimalai, they said women cannot go in a particular period when they're menstruating into the sanctum sanctorum. I was one of the first persons to stand up and say, what rubbish? And the pandits came to me, these priests came to me saying that we never expected you to say. I said, this is wrong. Tell me in one place where in our scriptures it says this. Even if the scripture said it, I'll say it's out of date, but it doesn't say it. So I think, what people say, I am not particularly bothered about till they start implementing it. Adityanath has many other good qualities. He's an extremely honest person. And he's 24 hours devoted to the task. I'm 100% certain he will restore the law and order in UP. And why wasn't he named? Because we named nobody. If we didn't give if we didn't give a single ticket to a Muslim, it's because no Muslim candidate came up who, in our thinking, was a winnable candidate. They were asking for tickets from Hindu areas, not from Muslim areas. But that too, if they were good candidates, we would have definitely done it. We don't want to be part of the normal rat race that we have to have 10% Muslim candidates and we have to put them in. And we said, let the people decide if they are against us. After all, 20% of the population of UP is Muslim, and there are about 125 constituencies where they dominate the results. By the way, in that 125, we have won 85 this time, with Hindu candidates. So these things are questions of dynamics of decision making, and I don't think there was any subterfuge. I can say one thing, I never expected that he would be the chief minister candidate. And in the initial stage, his name never came. And then suddenly it appeared because it's found that the consensus seemed to be more in his favor because most of the MLAs who were sampled, they preferred him. And that's why we made him, not because we wanted to hide this from the public.
Well, Dr. Swamy, you just said that you're not very concerned with what people say, but what they do. I think, again, that's a sleight of hand, and that's a kind of consolation prize for yourself. Because the thing is that very often when political figures say something, it has a subterranean impact on the ground. I'm sure you couldn't have been comfortable with the way Muhammad Akhlaq was pulled out of his house and lynched to death.
By whom?
By the neighbors, whoever it may be. I know that they were Hindus. You will agree that you might argue they were not. Let's assume they were ghosts. But he was killed. He was killed by bricks on the suspicion that he had cow meat in his fridge. A 12-year-old boy was strung up and hung on a tree in Jharkhand because of the climate that is being created by political speeches like this. So yes, you're not doing it, but you're creating an environment where that happens.
Who was in power when this happened, or this Akhlaq case?
Sir, they may have been in power, but like Mr. Modi was in power, but doesn't take accountability for what happened in Gujarat, Akhilesh doesn't take accountability for what happened then.
Modi never said that I don't take responsibility for all that has happened. But But to say that he was criminally complicit, that is what the courts have to prove. I can't go by your statements.
No, let's not go to Gujarat. We have something much more contemporary, as we said.
Here, Akhilesh has not even prosecuted them. Not even one person has been prosecuted. They have not filed an FIR naming these people.
I'm glad you bring this up, and I'm glad Akhilesh lost because he didn't live by his ideal as the leader. But may I suggest to you and put to you that Sangeet Som and the people who were really bhadkawing the crowd was rewarded by the BJP and given ministerships. Mahesh Sharma was rewarded for what he said. So are we always going to play this tic-tac game?
My view of Som and Mahesh Sharma, whom I know both very well, I don't believe they are the type of people who would go and say, kill this man, butcher him, etc. You say that, I can't accept it. Somewhere we have to have some agency which will decide this. Mr. Advani was thought of as a very suave man, but today he's the Supreme Court may in fact find him deserving of a charge sheet. We are not stopping it.
That's because he's no longer politically expedient.
You doubt my intentions.
Again, going by evidence. Mr. Advani is not crucial to the BJP party anymore.
No, this case has been going on even when Mr. Advani was
You know, we've never had as strong and muscular a leader as Mr. Modi. When he doesn't tweet about Mohammad Akhlaq, it says something. When he puts Aditya Nath as CM of UP, it says something, you know.
Your code on how a person should believe is something we will never accept.
Okay. Fine.
It's your code. I have my code. I will believe that taking anybody's life or putting any innocent person into misery is something I will, if I do, God will punish me, my karma will finish me. This is what we Hindus believe. Therefore, I don't believe that these stories. Now, as far as I have addressed several meetings with Aditya Nath. He's a very good friend of mine. And I've never seen him say this. He went to a riot area and he definitely said, he specifically targeted the criminal elements who are people who everybody knows who these criminal elements are. He said, he warned you that if you do it, we'll take 10 of you. That's what he said. He didn't say, I will kill 10 Muslims. You show me that tape, I'll be happy to write to him and tell him.
Sir,
how did you say this?
Dr. Swamy, may I suggest to you, as you said, you will not live by my code of conduct. I haven't actually articulated mine yet, so I don't know how you're dismissing it.
I can guess.
You can guess. See, we live with assumptions. May I suggest to you the political path there could have been to say that if you take anybody's life, I will ensure you land your ass in jail.
Yes.
Rather than to say, absolutely, I will take 100 of yours, you know?
No, but whether he said it or not, I have no evidence.
So if you just Google it, you'll find it.
I will Google it.
Please.
And send you since I have your email address, I'll send it to you.
I've seen it, so just see it yourself.
Yeah, but you might have seen it in Telka, I think, no?
No. He said it post Tehelka. It's happened now.
Okay.
And Dr. Swamy, again, have at no point insinuated anything when I'm having a conversation with you. To insinuate that Tehelka, which is a publication I headed in the past as a managing editor, that it had any agenda is, again, not based on fact. It's not based on evidence. So insinuation is
I'll let that pass.
Okay. Yeah. I'd just like to say that insinuation is poor intellectual tactic, you know.
No, it's not insinuation. I have experienced what you have said. I'll not go into it. It's not important.
Okay.
Because you have not misused government power to harm me in any way. So I have nothing against you.
Okay. Dr. Swamy, just, when we were speaking about, you've just moved a bill for death penalty for cow slaughter.
Yeah.
Again, why always in excesses, Dr. Swamy? You're really a sonata of excesses now, you know. And one last question, again to stay with Aditya Nath, if you can explain yourself on cow slaughter. And the second thing is that Aditya Nath, the first thing that he's done is to create Romeo squads. Your daughter married a Muslim man. These Romeo squads go around disrupting perfectly personal love relationships as a big civilizational affront, you know. Do you defend Romeo squads? Do you defend the idea of love jihad? Do you really believe that Hindu women are foolish enough to be kidnapped by Muslim men, and that there should be a vice versa going on, ghar wapasi. Are these things that you really feel intellectually close to?
Listen, first of all, I don't think you have read this statement of this morning, where he says, I have very categorically said, couples who are moving freely together, no one should touch them. He has made that statement. So he had got this report that they were disrupting everybody. So he has made that clarity. He has clarified that. So I will not go into that. The second question is, who any individual marries is none of my business. After all, I married a Parsi. Fortunately, I must say, my parents never objected. The Farsis objected because they are a small community.
They had a premonition.
Because I think they're a small community and they felt, you know, this is losing. I told them that, you see, in the Parsi community, if a man marries outside, he can marry a barmaid in England and their children become Parsis. I had, in fact, offered one. I have two daughters. I said one of them can be a Parsi. But the Parsi clerics didn't accept. So, I mean, I'm not on this issue, who can marry whom. This is a free choice. You choose it. Nobody can come in your way. This love jihad was created by the Kerala High Court, which said that there was a systematic, motivated program to lure unsuspecting women and then convert them and then abandon them. This is a judgment of this Kerala High Court. And then it caught fire, that word. Even here, we have to be very careful. And I certainly think that if any example comes where people of their own free will meet together and they are harassed, I'll be happy to take it up with the Chief Minister and tell him this must stop. We are not for it at all. We are bound by the Constitution. And the Constitution, one day OYC said he was also bound by the Constitution. I said, Constitution says that cow slaughter should be banned. Are you now bound to, would you accept that? He said, no, that part I don't accept. Then I asked him, what about Uniform Civil Code? That's also in the Constitution. He said, that part also I don't accept. In the end, maybe he won't accept the Constitution, but the fact is that when it comes to cow slaughter, it is such a profitable business to export it, particularly to Bangladesh and Pakistan. So there are illegal movements that take place. When I say death sentence, doesn't mean that the moment a person is found to have either slaughtered a cow or he has smuggled out a large number of cows for slaughter, that he should be immediately given the death sentence. The Supreme Court has made it very clear, death sentence can be only in the rarest of rare cases. But we need a deterrent punishment. At the present time, it's on some 5,000 rupees and I think 2 months in jail. That's hardly a punishment. People happily go and come back. The fact of the matter is that I'm trying to awaken the consciousness, because this Bos Indicus breed is an extraordinary breed, which I can give you magazines, scientific magazines in the United States, which says that the milk of this particular variety is something completely different from the from all the milk that is available in the Western world and elsewhere. This now, in fact, if you please check through Google, New Zealand is seriously thinking of banning Bos Indicus, which is the Indian variety of cow, their slaughter in New Zealand. So I just based on some scientific analysis which I have done, and I've come to the conclusion that somehow we must not only, and my bill, by the way, only is not only about capital punishment, it's about establishing an authority which will go into the how cows are bred in this country, how they are abandoned, how to take care of them after they become too old to be of any use. They shouldn't be allowed in the street. All that into account. And therefore, if we can make imprisonment of 7 years for killing a peacock, you know that we have a law which says you can't kill a peacock. Why shouldn't we have a law which is severely bans or deterrent punishment for the treatment of cows? So that's all it is.
Okay, we've run out of time. I'm going to open this up to the House. We haven't even started touching on economy, which is a whole other minefield of interesting things where Dr. Swamy is concerned. what he said about Raghuram Rajan, what he said about Arun Jaitley. Before I start taking audience questions, can you really treat us as privileged audience and give us your off the record version of what happened to the GDP after demonetization kicked in?
Well, well, I mean, you put me in a dilemma whether I should become an economist or a politician. The GDP growth, human. Well, after they all, her class has brutalized me for so many years, I can't be.
Thank you for that unvarnished truth, Dr. Swamy. You've been loyal to that idea of being intellectual, so thank you. Thank you for being privileged enough, allowing us to be privileged enough to hear that, the unvarnished truth about the GDP. I'd like to ask you that, you know, we do as club members offer our speakers Chatham House rules. So can we share this, or would you like us not to share this?
Well, you can share amongst yourself, but I don't want to see it in the newspaper. Okay. But if it comes in the newspaper, it won't. I mean, it's like water off a duck's back. It won't affect me. But the fact of the matter is that it will be make me a little more careful next time.
No, we don't want to add to this, you know, this volcanic cynicism that drives you, Dr. Swamy. We can be sure of that. So let me open this up to questions from the audience. There's one here.
Dr. Swamy, right here. I'll stand up. Do you think absolute power corrupts? And if you see the current dispensation of BJP with its absolute power that it's getting across the country become corrupt or become a theocratic state, would you then stand in opposition against that?
First of all, the corruption of the UPA period was brought out by not their own people, but by people in the opposition like myself. These last 3 years, I have not seen any congressperson bring out any case of corruption which stands the test of the court. There are all kinds of remarks made, but none of that. And in fact, the last one where an attempt was made was in the Sahara Diaries matter. The Supreme Court threw it out. Now, therefore, I would assume, for your sake, because if you may not believe what I say as a partisan BJP man, but there is nothing on record to show that the present dispensation at the level of the Prime Minister is corrupt. Number two, I have found in my interaction with him that when I bring him to his notice that something is not being prosecuted, he has immediately ordered the prosecution. When I've told him that such and such officer is actually corrupt and or he belongs to the previous administration and he's helping the people of the previous administration, he has made the change. So there is no way I can today say that Mr. Narendra Modi, having so much absolute power, is engaged in any corruption at all. Second, I don't even think that he has absolute power. Because if he had absolute power, according to me, Adityanath would not have been chief minister. He was not his choice. And yet he yielded.
That's big news. That might make it to the news.
No, I don't mind it being made into news. But the fact is that this is the truth. For 4 or 5 days, some other name was there. I think Manu Sinha or something like that. It was one of the ministers of state. And it was the single name. And then suddenly, by other people, they said, no person who can manage the MLAs is Adityanath, and that's how he came, and he agreed with it. He didn't disagree with it, he didn't fight it, but he agreed with it, but he never proposed it. The proposal was for Manu Sinha. So I don't see him being, although he appears to be a very strong, you know, strong-willed person, etc., I have not seen him in our dealings in the party as a dictator. And it's very difficult for him to be dictator with me around because I will speak up. I can give you that assurance, the one who asked. Any wrong happens, I will speak up. For instance, on GST, I'm not going to let it come. I'm going to knock it out. It's the most anti-national the thing that I ever thought of. It is not even originally our idea. It is the idea of that crazy Chidambaram.
Sorry, I can't see because the light is in.
There was one here.
Here, and then we'll geographically go there after
here
that.
Also.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes. No, Modi is not the same thing as Modi is India and India is Modi. In fact, there was Har Har Modi, one slogan had come. And Modi immediately put a stop to it because it's very close to Har Har Mahadev, you see. And therefore, he disallowed it. So I don't think they are two are comparable. And see, you must also know one thing which many people don't realize, although when brought to their attention, they will probably accept. Our party, there is no one family which runs the party, unlike most other parties. Modi's family doesn't run. There's no way Modi can decide who the successor will be. And there are countervailing forces which are, what I will say, passive, but on occasions they can be mobilized. I would not be today a member of parliament, but for the fact that these countervailing forces in our party put its foot down and said, no more, because I was supposed to be a Lok Sabha candidate for BJP from New Delhi. And I was forced to leave my old constituency of Bombay and come here by Nitin Gadkari and Rajnath Singh. And then my name was declared, I started working, and the day before my nomination, I get a call that Mr. Jetli has a hysterical breakdown, saying I'm not a Punjabi and therefore I should not be given the ticket. I never knew that BJP thought in terms of Punjabis and Madrasis. And actually New Delhi has no Punjabis, there's mostly Madrasis anyway. But doesn't matter. But then after that, 2.5 years passed by and suddenly the countervailing forces said, what is this going on? And that's how I came in. So this party, all said and done, is structured in such a way that one person cannot dominate it. That I am personally convinced from having known them for such a long time.
We'll just take one. I'm really sorry. Well, two questions, Payal, if we have time.
There's one here. He's been.
Let's just go geographically to the back because we haven't taken any from there. One there, and then Saeed.
At times, I wonder that how do you get all the information on which politician has how much investments in which asset class?
Yeah.
You must have got a real strong research team working for you.
Yeah, you see, I have made one rule in my life, which is the opposite of everybody else. I never publicize my friends, but I publicize my enemies. I have never let down people who have come and given me information. You know that in the 2G matter, the personal secretary of Mr. Raja, he was the one who gave me the material. I never let him down. And Raja and the entire
You're
Congress...
You're not letting him down now?
Now I let him down because I brought him into the party. He's now a member of the party. So, therefore, and then, see, I have some other unique situations. I went to a public school in Delhi. It was called Delhi Public School, but it was those days called Church High School. Then I went to college here. My father was a secretary. My father-in-law was an ICS. And then, of course, I spent years in Harvard. So that network is today sustaining me in getting this information.
Dr. Swamy, I'm sorry. I'm going to have to cut in. And I'm sorry. We can't. I didn't realize. I've just looked at the phone. We have another speaker. So I'm really going to close this here. I myself feel that it's been good to have you here, Dr. Swamy. I think it speaks for the spirit of debate and courteous conversation. I think we begin to understand each other a little bit better. I hope that this exiling of each other doesn't happen. Yes, there are some differences in opinion, but we have been reaching out to the BJP, and I hope you're our emissary to get more of your party to come here, to speak with us, to take on questions that we'd like to ask.
Maybe I'll ask Aditya Nath to come here.
Yes, I'd like that. I'd like that. So thank you very much. This is not a finished conversation. I didn't mean it facetiously. We should have Dr. Swamy back to test and challenge his views. On many grounds, I did give him a free pass. I would love to challenge him more. But let's put an end to this conversation. Thank you very much. I just want to end with one thing which did bother me a little bit, is when you said that how would Hindu minorities have been treated in Muslim majority countries, that Muslims are treated so well in our country. I say this as a Hindu, I say this as a proud Indian, that I'm ashamed of how Muslims are treated in our country, because if you read the Satcher Committee report, Muslims are in many ways in a worse position than Dalits, and there is much to be done, much positive things to be done to really lift this country to where it should be, with the spirit that imbues Hinduism, rather than exacerbating the separations, Dr. Swamy. And I hope you become an eloquent crusader for that. Thank you so much. I'm not going to let you have the last word. We have Manish Tiwari. Can we please make the drinks break really short? Because that's a whole other fascinating conversation waiting to happen. See you back in 15 minutes. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Swamy.